أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف خلق الله أجمعين، سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، ومن تبعهم بإحسان واقتفى أثرهم وسار على نهجهم إلى يوم الدين. In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful, all praise belongs to Allah, peace and blessings of Allah be upon our beloved, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and those who follow him rightly and correctly till the day of resurrection. Dear brothers and sisters, first and foremost, I would like to salute you all with the salutation of peace, with the salutation of love, with the salutation of the people of paradise, تحيتهم يوم يلقونه سلام. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Just a few remarks before we start. I was asked by the organizing committee to ask you all to mute your microphones and also to switch your cameras off. If any of you is interested over the course of this lecture to ask any particular question, he can ask a question by raising the hand, and I'll allow him, inshallah ta'ala, to ask his question over the course of this discussion. I hope that both the camera and the microphone are clear. My voice is clear, and inshallah ta'ala, we'll make a start. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we'll be talking about the month of Ramadan in these exceptional days. We are nowadays in these exceptional days, in these, as they say, uncertain days. These days, the whole world experience a very big challenge. That is what's called coronavirus, or COVID-19, what it came to be known as COVID-19. And the world nowadays is united like never before against this virus, fighting this virus. And what is so important is that we need to derive lessons from this pandemic that the world experienced. Because the world before that was busy fighting one another, fight each one country fights the other country, and so on and so forth. But today the world is united against this common enemy, the virus. And what is so important is that when this over, inshallah ta'ala, it would be over sooner than later, when this is over, the whole world will remain united, will let go these divisions that we saw in the previous years and in the previous days. So what concerns us nowadays, over the following few days is the month of Ramadan. I know it is very sad. It's very hard for each one of us to approach the month of Ramadan without being in the mosque. This is really very hard, that this year we will have the month of Ramadan without going to the mosque. It's really very hard. The souls, I know, long to going to the mosque and to pray at Taraweeh in the mosque. But who knows what is better for us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Perhaps you hate a thing that is better for you, and perhaps you love a thing that is bad for you. and look at the conclusion of this verse. Wallahu ya'lamu wa antum la ta'lamu. Allah knows while you don't, know. So who knows the wisdom? Allah knows the wisdom. We may love something, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses for us another thing. So inshallah ta'ala, as announced, we'll be talking about fiqh of Ramadan or jurisprudence of Ramadan, the rules, regulations that concern Ramadan, especially due to this COVID-19, or in general, when one is restricted from performing his fast or restricting from going to the mosque, how to fast during these days if he's sick, and how can he perform a Taraweeh prayer if he cannot go to the mosque. So I'll be happy to receive your questions. One can raise his hand, although the chat isn't clear to me while displaying these slides, but I can check the chat later on. So I'll be allowing people to pose their questions, or they can alternatively type their questions in the chat. So let's go to the first question, the first obvious, one of the obvious questions. Does coronavirus test break the fast? We know that the government now is having a campaign to test as many people as they can. If one has this test during the day of Ramadan, does that invalidate his fast? And the answer to this question is that the answer to this question is that this test, this type of test, does not invalidate one's fasting, because it's just like a swab taken from one's nose or from one's throat. So it doesn't invalidate. It's not like a vomit. It's just a small swab sample taken from his nose or from his throat, then being examined. So no, it doesn't invalidate one fast. There are invalidators for the fasting, but none of them is just taking a swab. And the scholars disagree on donating blood, taking blood from one's body. But according to the narration that the Prophet, peace be upon him, cupped while it had cupping, which we call higama in Arabic, during the day of his fast. So this doesn't invalidate and should not invalidate one's fast. We'll be mentioning, inshallah ta'ala, other issues, whether or not they invalidate the fast. Okay, let me check the chat, because I have no access now to the chat. Maybe to just make sure that everything is going smooth. Okay, it's clear. It seems the voice is clear. So yeah, we will continue. So the second question, does COVID-19 patient have to fast? Well, generally speaking, many people even ask without contracting or having any symptoms of COVID-19, do they have to fast or not? Generally speaking, any Muslim should fast as long as he is able to fast. And in fact, our Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, told us that fasting strengthens one's immune system. So it is a defensive mechanism for one to fast in order to strengthen his immune system. The Prophet, peace be upon him, says, "Sawmu tasahhu," fast so that you get healthy. So the one who doesn't have any disease should fast. He has to fast. And the one who has disease, yes, he could break his fast, but on condition. Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. Whoever amongst you is sick or on a journey, then an equal number of days are to be made up. If he breaks a number of days, these days are to be made up when Ramadan is over. So one of the excuses for one to leave the fast is to be sick or on a journey. If he is traveling away, for example, if he is abroad and he saw there's a hardship with fasting, then he can, in this case, break his fast. And the second reason is that if he is sick, whoever amongst you is sick, فَمِنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرْ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. And the scholars divided the sick person into three categories. If the disease, the first category, if the disease, if fasting causes harm to him and hurts him, then in this case, he should not fast. He must refrain, actually, from fasting. If the fasting worsens his situation, delay the cure from the disease, if fasting worsens and make the situation exacerbated, then in this case, he must leave fasting. The only duty upon him in this case is he to make up the days that he missed during the days of Ramadan. So this is the first condition, that if the disease, COVID-19 or any disease, worsens his situation or delays the healing or make it very bad for him, then he must refrain. And the second case, if the disease makes it hard upon him, he can still fast, he's able to fast, but it would be very hard for him to fast. So in this case, it is also recommended to break his fast. In the first case, it is a must that he breaks his fast if fasting hurts him. And on both cases, one should consult the doctor. His doctor, one should seek medical attention and see his doctor and ask him about his case, whether he can fast or he cannot fast. One shouldn't be carried away and overexcited by Ramadan and insists on fasting. No, that may harm him, and we are asked not to harm and hurt ourselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ. Don't ruin yourself, yourself. So these are two cases in which it's either a must to break your fast, okay, or it is recommended to break your fast. The third case is to, if the disease doesn't hurt you and doesn't inflict hardship upon you, then you have to fast in this case. For example, if one has a seasonal flu, normal flu, or just have a headache and toothache, for example, a headache, especially many experience headache during over the beginning days or in the first days of Ramadan, because they are used to certain drinks, for example, they have headaches. In this case, yes, they can, they cannot break their fast, because fasting involves hardship, a little of hardship. So one has to fast. This is normal hardship. The nature of fasting requires that. So let's go to the third question. Does the ventilator break once fast? Many people, may Allah forbid, has to undergo ventilator system in order for them to be able to breathe, especially those nowadays who are contracted COVID-19. There's a high demand on ventilators nowadays. So does ventilator break once fast? The answer to that, if one can fast, then the ventilator doesn't break his fast, doesn't invalidate his fast, because it's helping, it's only helping the sick person to breathe well. It doesn't insert liquids, it's only helping the lungs to breathe and to have oxygen, enough oxygen for him so he can survive. So in terms of ventilators, it doesn't, they don't break once fast if he is able to fast in the first place, but he might have other disease complications that prevent him from fasting. In that case, he should consult this doctor, and he is excused if the doctor said to him, you don't have to fast. Because this is one of excuses enshrined in the Holy Quran. And the doctor, by the way, doesn't have to be a Muslim. If the doctor is trustworthy, experienced in his field, honest, then he doesn't have to be a Muslim in order for you to take his advice. Okay, so let's go to the fourth question or the following question. Okay, does the inhaler break the fast if one has an asthma, for example? The inhaler is just like the ventilator, it helps one to breathe. However, sometimes in the inhaler there are droplets, small, very very small, tiny droplets that could enter into one's body. And the scholars, the modern scholars, dispute on this issue, whether that breaks one fast, these small droplets, or not. And the correct opinion with our scholars nowadays is that that shouldn't break one's fast. That is allowed even during the day of the fast, even if one is fasting, because these droplets are insignificant, are very, very tiny and small droplets. And this ruling is derived by means of analogy, or what we call in Arabic qiyas. That is because when we rinse our mouth, with water, or rinse the inside of the nose, doctors say there are small droplets go inside the body, and these droplets are very very small, and we can know from allowing us to rinse our mouth and the inside of the nose while having droplets going inside our body, we know that these small drops are tolerated in Islam. So any medicine that involve, for example, small, very, very small drops going inside the body, then these drops are tolerated and they don't break once fast. For example, if one has to put eye drops, for example, then he doesn't have to break his fast. He can continue fasting while having eye drops or even nose drops, unless the amount of these drops are large, especially if they are inserted from the nose, because the nose has a bigger opening compared to the others. Okay, let me now check the chat if there are any questions. Okay, so yeah, we can go ahead. There are no questions. I think. Okay, so let's go back to the slide. And to the following question. Okay, do the following break the fast, eye drop, we've just said, according to the authentic opinion, eye drop does not break one's fast. If one has to take eye drop while he's fasting during the day of fast, even if he tastes the medicine in his throat, that doesn't invalidate his fast. Nose drop, I said, if it is very small amount of medicine, then it also doesn't break one's fast. But if it is a large drops or drip, for example, inserted from nose, then this breaks one's fast, because usually it would be a large amount of medicine. Injections. The modern scholars disputed a lot about injections, but I'm not going to quote all their opinions. Some scholars injections said all sorts of injections invalidate one's fasting. The other hold the opposite opinion. Injections don't invalidate one's fasting. But here I choose for you the opinion of our Grand Mufti, the Grand Mufti of the Sultanate of Oman, His Eminence, Sheikh Ahmed bin Hamad al-Khalili. He said that we should distinguish between injections. That depends on the liquid injected by these injections. If it contains liquids that are nutrients, which means they are meant to feed the body, then these injections invalidate the fast. If he has to take them during the day of the fast, then he takes them and he makes up for this day when Ramadan is over. And by the way, here what I'm gonna say applies to all what I have just mentioned earlier and what I'm gonna mention. If these medicines can be taken during the night, then that is what should be done. If one can take eye drop or any type of medicine during at night, then what should be done? He should avoid taking them during the day of fast. That is more precautious, to be taken at night, not during the day. However, due to some medical advice, due to health conditions, one has to resort sometimes to taking them while he is fasting. So if one can take them at night, then that is for sure better. He will be out of the disputes between modern scholars. So if the injection, back to the injection, if the injection is including nutrients, then it breaks one fast and he can continue eating, drinking after he took this injection, nutritious injection. But if this injection is just mere medicine, it doesn't have fluids that are meant to feed the body, they only have, for example, medicine like insulin, according to the reliable opinion, insulin for the diabetic people, the insulin does not break once fast because it has only medicine. It's meant to regulate some functions of the body. Now let's move to the drip. The drip usually is meant to nourish the body when one is unable to take the food by himself or by mouth. Usually he is given the drip, and usually the drip contains nutritious liquids, so this breaks one's fast. We'll come to what he has to do, how can one make what he missed of fasting, inshallah ta'ala, later on. There will be a question dedicated for that. Okay, medicine, for example, inserted into one's bladder that doesn't break one's fast because the bladder doesn't have strong connection with the stomach or intestines. So any medicine taken through bladder, any material substance inserted to one's bladder doesn't break his fast. Uterus also, womb of the mother, doesn't break her fast. If anything inserted to her uterus, injected to her uterus, that doesn't break her fast because the uterus doesn't have strong connection with the parts of the body that absorb nutrition and food. The intestine or the back that have strong connection because the bottom has a connection, strong connection with the small and large intestine where food is mainly observed. So any nutrition inserted from one's anus, for example, then that breaks his fast. And he should make up for this day because as a matter of fact, intestines, whether large intestines or small intestines, are part of one's digestive system. So they digest food, they absorb nutrients. So in that case, yes, they break the fast. Unless it is a very small amount of for example, fluids. Just like we said when we spoke about eye drop or nose drop. Okay, donating blood. Does donating blood invalidate one's fast? No, according to the reliable opinion, because we have a narration related to us from Ibn Abbas. May Allah have mercy on him. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anh mentioned that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, had cupping while he was fasting. So this indicates that taking blood does not invalidate one's fast. And also donating blood during the day of the fast doesn't invalidate one's blood. However, if he has to take some liquids after donating the blood, or he has to take glucose, for example, then that definitely would invalidate his fasting. So in that case, he should donate blood at night, not during the daytime, if he has to take some liquids, for example. And this applies to what I mentioned earlier and what I'm gonna mention later, inshallah ta'ala. If one can avoid taking or doing any of these during the day of fast, then that is what is preferable. Okay, so donating the blood. And any blood coming from the body does not invalidate one's fast. For example, if a blood is taken as a blood test, for example, a sample of his blood is taken for medical test or checkup, that doesn't invalidate his fast as well. Extracting one's teeth, if one has to take one of, to take away, to take out one of his tooth, that doesn't invalidate his fast, even if that caused him to bleed. Nosebleed as well does not invalidate one's fast. That is fine, inshallah ta'ala. All blood coming out from the body does not invalidate one's fast, except one blood, that is menstruation blood, the blood of the period. That is the only blood that invalidates one's fast. Dialysis, which is known to clean the the blood and returning the blood again to the body. This breaks the fast because it involves usually liquids inserted in the blood and liquids put in the blood and going back to the body. So yeah, dialysis, cleaning blood by these machines, those for those who have kidney failure, may Allah forbid, has to undergo this process of dialysis. And it involves putting sometimes liquids in the blood after being filtered and returned to the body. So this breaks the fast. Okay, so we'll move to the other slide. Can breastfeeding and pregnant woman break her fast or break their fast? It depends. If she fears, the mother fears for her own health or for her baby, then yes, she can break her fast. But if everything is normal, she can normally breastfeed her child, or she isn't afraid after consulting the doctor of her youth, of her baby, okay, in her womb, then that is fine. She has to continue fasting. But if her doctor says to her, she has to break her fast because this constitutes or poses threat to her baby, whether the baby being breastfed or the baby in her womb, then in this case, she must refrain from fasting. And she has to cease fasting and she has to eat and drink. And later on, she has to make up for the days that she missed in Ramadan. Many people ask, does she have to pay ransom if she is to break her fast for breastfeeding or for having a child, for being pregnant? No, she doesn't have to pay a ransom. And we will speak about the ransom later on. She only has to make up for these days when Ramadan is over, when her health conditions are no longer there. Okay, so this is a very frequent question. If one has to break his fast due to an illness, what is he or she required to do later? Yes. I referred to this earlier. If for any reason one has to break his fast or her fast for any health conditions, he has to take a medicine that we established earlier, it breaks his fast, then in this case, he has to do one thing. He has to first one thing to break his fast, then to make up for these days that he missed during the days of Ramadan. Does he have to pay or does she have to pay a ransom? No, she doesn't have to pay a ransom. She doesn't have to pay a ransom. A ransom has a specific occasions. That is, if one has a chronic disease, what we have mentioned usually are not a chronic conditions. They are temporary conditions. However, if one has to break his fast permanently, I mean, he doesn't expect to be healed, to recover, and to be able to fast, in this case, he has to pay a ransom. He has to pay a ransom. And he doesn't have to make up for the fast. If his condition is permanent and chronic. For example, if one has to take his medicine from by drip, for example, or if one has to take dialysis every day, for example, I mean any condition that cannot be removed and it's always with him during the days of the year, it's always permanent with him, then in this case he has to resort to paying a ransom or expiation. So what is a ransom? What is a ransom? A ransom is to feed one poor person for each day that one has missed. And this is according to the verse in the Holy Quran where the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. Whoever among you is sick and on a journey, فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. He doesn't have to pay a ransom, just as we mentioned earlier. He has only to make up what he missed of fasting. Then the verse continues saying, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينٍ. And those among you who are able to fast but with hardship, they have to pay a ransom, a substitute of feeding one poor person. And the amount to feed this one poor person is either one meal, you give them, for example, lunch, just as you feed your own children, or be it dinner or lunch, breakfast, any meal, one meal for each day. Or you give them half a sa' of food like rice, for example. And the sa' is an old type of measurement. It's used usually to measure food. It's not a type to weigh things, but it is a type of measuring food by volume, not by weight. And the scholars say nisf sa', half a sa', nowadays is equal, if it is given by rice, it is equal to 1 kilogram 0.048. 1 kilogram, 1 kilogram 0.024. So 1 full sa' is 2 kilogram 0.048, while half a sa', only half of that, 1 kilogram 0.024. This is half a sa'. So if one gives rice, he has to give for each day 1 kilogram 0.024. So it doesn't mean 1 kilogram and quarter of kilogram, because this is not 0.24, it's just 0.024. So this is half a sa'. If one has to break his fast or he is permanently unable to fast due to his illness, then he has to pay a ransom for each day. Okay? But if he is able to make up, then he doesn't have to pay ransom. He only has to make up any day during the year before the following Ramadan. One should pay attention not to let the following Ramadan to come unless he has made up what he have of Ramadan. Okay. I think we have here a chat. So let's go to the chat. Okay. We have a question here from our brother Saleh al-Bahri. From London, from Gaber bin Zayed Center in London. He's saying, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. What if a woman has successive pregnancies and is unable to fast for a few years? Does vomiting break the fast? So we have two questions here from Brother Saleh al-Bahri from London. If a woman has successive pregnancies and on the doctor advice, she should refrain from fasting, but she expects one day she will not be pregnant and she can make up what she missed, then in this case she should wait. She shouldn't resort to making up, or she shouldn't resort to giving a ransom or fidya. We call it in Arabic fidya. Rather, she should wait until she is able to make up, because successive pregnancies are not permanent. I'm sure one day she's expected be free from pregnancy and she can make up inshallah ta'ala. So this is regarding his first question. Regarding his second question, does vomiting break the fast? It depends. If one caused himself to vomit, yes, that breaks his fast. And if vomiting came out of his control, then that does not break his fast. Okay. And there is a narration here reported or ascribed to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in which the Prophet, peace be upon him, mentioned or reported or ascribed to him that he mentioned that if one vomits intentionally, then he broke his fast. And if one vomits not intentionally, then his fast is sound. Although the meaning of this narration is correct, but the chain of narrators are not authentic, but the meaning is still correct. So if one vomits intentionally, then he broke his fast. Yes. But if that out of his control, he didn't control that, he had to vomit, then in this case, his fast is sound. Can I still fast when I'm traveling? Yes, one can still fast while he is traveling according to the majority opinion of the scholars. The scholars of Islam understood from the verse, فَمِنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ, that one has the option either to fast or not to fast if he is on a travel. And many of our scholars prefer that he fast if he is able, because the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concluded the verse by saying, وَأَن تَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ, to fast is better for you if you know. Okay, we have another question from Brother Saeed Al-Mandri. At COVID-19 situation, how about Salah al-Tarawih? Is going to be at that situation? I'm going to answer this question, actually. So it's one of the questions in my slides. So I'm going to run quickly into my slides. So we'll address the Tarawih prayer issue. Yes, this is the question regarding Tarawih prayer. What is a Tarawih prayer and how is it performed? Tarawih prayer is part of Qiyam Ramadan. And Qiyam Ramadan is divided into three phases. The first phase is a Tarawih prayer, which is from Al-Isha prayer till midnight. This is called a Tarawih prayer. Then comes a Tahajjud prayer from midnight till the beginning of the last third of the night. This is called a Tahajjud prayer. The last on the last, the prayer that is performed in the last third of the night is called As-Sahar. That time is called As-Sahar, and the prayer during that time is called As-Sahar prayer. And all is considered a Tarawih prayer, and all falls under the prophetic statement, من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه وما تأخر. Whoever stands in prayer during the nights of Ramadan out of faith and in the hope of reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه وما تأخر, then his previous sins are forgiven. And as to how is it is performed, it's at-Tarawih prayer is 8 rak'ah prayer. Just as the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, performed at-Tarawih, it's 8 rak'ah prayer. And that does not include al-Isha, obligatory prayer, and this also does not include the Sunnah right after al-Isha. So after the Sunnah of al-Isha, you pray 8 rak'ah, and you separate each 2 rak'ah with the tasleem. So you pray 2 units, 2 units, 2 units, and 2 units. So this is al-Isha prayer. This is a Tarawih prayer. It is prayed in twos, 2 by 2, for the prophetic statement, Salatul Layli Mathna Mathna. the prayer performed in the night are 2 by 2. So one has to give salam after each 2 rak'ah. And he can say dua after 4 rak'ah. And that is why it is called at-taraweeh. Because people in the past prolonged their at-taraweeh prayer, and they had to take a rest, which is raha. And from here, at-taraweeh word is derived from the raha, which is having a rest after each 4 rak'ah. And during this rest, the imam recites supplication. And can one pray at-taraweeh at his house? Yes. Generally speaking, any prayer apart from the 5 obligatory prayers for men are better to be performed in the house, at one's house, not in the mosque. And this applies during the normal times. This is what I'm saying is not confined to the pandemic time, to the disease times, the plague times. This applies to any time. The sunan, the voluntary sunan, optional sunan, they are better to be performed at one's house, not in the mosque. Whether they are related to the prayer performed before or after prayer, which are called al-rawatib, as-sunan al-rawatib, usually people perform them at mosque, but if they can perform them at one's house, then that is better, because this is the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So at-taraweeh is no, at-taraweeh could be performed at one's house. In fact, the Prophet only performed at-taraweeh at his mosque only for 2 or 3 nights, for 3 nights. Then he feared it would be made obligatory upon his companions and by extension upon us. So he ceased to go to the mosque and he prayed at-taraweeh at his house. So yes, it can be prayed at one's house. It can be prayed in congregation with the members of the family. It's an opportunity for one to get his children to pray taraweeh at house, to revive the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, to pray at taraweeh as well at one's house. Only Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala gathered people to pray at taraweeh at the mosque again after the Prophet's demise. So yes, and I know many of us, many of you, all of you are longing to the mosque to pray taraweeh at mosque, to listen to that recitation from the imam. But who knows, let be the leader, be the imam in your house, be that reciter that you used to hear in the mosque, be the reciter yourself, the reciter and the imam at your own house. Be the leader to your children, to your family members. It's a family union at one's house. And as I quoted the verse, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Perhaps you hate a thing, but it turns out to be good for you. And perhaps you love a thing and it turns out to be bad for you. And Allah knows while you don't know. It can be prayed in congregation, taraweeh prayer. And many people nowadays ask about the rose. How can they make their rose? I discussed this issue in my book, Al-Mu'tamad. I wonder if I can share a screen of that. Yes, this is from our book Al-Mu'tamad, if it is clear to you. I mentioned I have a full section on the places of the followers behind the imam, the ma'mumin behind the imam. How can they straighten their rows, and whether they pray behind, next to the imam, or behind the imam. Also, if women are there with the imam, sections on the places of the women behind her imam. Generally speaking, if there is one ma'mum, one follower with the imam, he has to pray next to him. If there is a woman, sorry, if there is one ma'moom, he has to pray next to the imam. If there are two male ma'mooms, they have to pray behind the imam. If they have a female, for example, then she has, according to opinion, pray behind them. Even if she is alone, she has to pray behind them. And this is according to authentic narration from Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala an, in which he mentioned that he and the orphan prayed behind the Prophet and the woman prayed behind them both. But according to other opinion, a woman, if she is closely related to the men, for example, her mom, for example, their mom, if she is their mom or sister, according to narration, she can pray next to them. So this is an issue of dispute, and either way, it should be all right. It should be all right, whether she prays next to them or she prays in independent new row behind the imam. And it's worth saying, when they pray behind the imam, when they initiate new row, the row has to be from the center behind the imam, from the back of the imam. So this is related to where they should stand. They should stand behind the imam. They should start their row from behind the imam. Because once prayer is invalid, if they start the row from the edge of the row, I mean, there was no sitra behind the imam. So thank you for listening. It's 10 a.m. We're running out of time. But if you have questions, you can either raise your hand or you can pose type your question. So I'm done with my talk now. And if you have any question, please type it or raise your hand. We will allow you to ask your question. I know Ramadan is different this year, but one of the objectives of Islam is to protect oneself. We have 5 objectives in Islam to protect. They are called the 5 necessities of Islam: to protect one's religion, to protect one's body, to protect one's intellect and mind, to protect one's offspring, and to protect one's wealth. So protecting one's body is one of the objectives and one of the 5 necessities of Islam. So when we refrain from going to the mosque, we are actually doing a form of worship. When we are maintaining social distancing, we are making a form of worship. We have here Brother Hilal Rashidi. Okay, unmute. So Brother Hilal, you can ask your question.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Alaikum assalam, Brother Hilal.
Okay. Sheikh, I have one comment or as a question to clarify about vomiting.
Yes.
In case someone is vomiting without intention.
Yes.
Is there any problem if anything goes back to his stomach?
Okay. He should take all precautions not to get it inside his stomach. But if things goes wrong and unintentionally went back to his stomach, then he isn't held responsible for that. It's just like anything that could go unintentionally to one's body. If a fly, for example, goes to one's inside body, to his stomach, then he is not held accountable for that. If he out of forgetfulness, then he isn't held accountable for that. And this, if the vomit is not in his control. But if he vomits intentionally, as I mentioned earlier, then he has broken his fast. Okay, Sheikh. Thank you, Sheikh Hilal. We have another question here. Sheikh, someone asked, Assalamu alaikum. In Ramadan, I don't want my sons to know that I'm in my period. How I will pretend myself performing salah? I mean, if this son is an adult or almost reaching the age of puberty, he can be told, it can be made clear to him that a woman, because of her nature, part of her nature, but part of her normal life, she ceased to praying during particular times. I think that should be explained to him. The scholars say a woman should not pretend doing all acts of salah while she is not, she isn't supposed to pray during her period. So it should be made clear to him in one way or another that it's part of woman's normal life to experience period, or not to at least pray during certain days of the month. Brother Saleh Al-Habsi, can we have a Taraweeh prayer online in this situation? I mean, this question was asked even before COVID-19. And although the Sunan prayer is more tolerable than the obligatory prayer, but still our scholars don't prefer that one perform his prayer online. I mean, one can pray, on his own or with his family members, but not online. It's not preferable in the fatwa with our scholars. However, there are scholars who allowed that, to perform the prayer, the sunan and the optional prayer online or following a TV. Some of them even go to the extent that one can follow the Taraweeh prayer in Al-Haram, Al-Makki or Al-Haram, Al-Madani. But our scholars are not in favor of this viewpoint. And Allah knows best. Any other question? We will sign out shortly, but if we have one or more questions, we can address, inshallah ta'ala, that question. So Ramadan, as I said, needs preparation. Ramadan is the ninth month of the year, and it needs preparation, just like any form of worship. And the best preparation for Ramadan is to arm and equip yourself with the right knowledge. The Prophet, peace be upon him, says, "Man arada Allahu bi khayran faqahahu fi din." Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good for him, he will make him knowledgeable in the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should be armed with the sound knowledge, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he asks us to worship him, he asks us to worship in a particular way that is pleasing to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should not deviate from that way. We should not worship Allah out of our whims or desires. We should follow the right path that is of the authentic scholars who derive the rulings from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and from the sunnah of his prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And we have 1 week, Ramadan is around the corner. So we have 1 week to prepare more, inshallah ta'ala. And I think if we don't have a question, then I should remind myself and you that we should utilize each moment of Ramadan to worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether reciting the Holy Quran, whether praying, whether educating our children it's good to have a dhikr session. It's an opportunity. As I said, who knows, maybe this is for our good, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted us to worship Him in different ways. There is only a single way to reach to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are so many ways to reach to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So worship is not confined to the rituals only. Raising children, educating children, and raising awareness, delivering or attending online lectures are, inshallah ta'ala, part of worshipping Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we said, من أراد الله به خيرا فقهه في الدين. And so I think if there is no question, I'm gonna conclude our session today. And thank you for attending and being part of this session. And I ask the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to fast Ramadan in the way that is pleasing to Him. And I pray to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant a speedy recovery to those who are sick, and to save the rest of Muslims, the rest of humans from this disease. And this disease will be eliminated, will be over soon by the will of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that the world would be a better place for humans to live than it was before. إنه ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. I'll try to share the recording with the organizing committee, inshallah ta'ala, because the whole session was recorded. إِنَّهُ وَلِيُّ ذَلِكَ وَالْقَادِرُ عَلَيْهِ. وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.